What do you think about containers? Are they useful? Okay, it's not only about containers, it's also about logical volumes, stateful containers, or virtual machines, KVM or whatever. So what I want to talk about is a new method for load balancing. That's the headline of all of it. I like to spend some time on motivation, but it depends on you how far we should go there. So we can talk with each other interactively, or you can ask some questions and I can adapt to it. We can have some discussions about it. No problem for me because we have plenty of time, 1 hour, and I've prepared some slides, about 16 by default, which should be enough. And I have some additional slides when necessary, but it depends on you. What do you do with it? Basic idea is background migration of the data, in this case, several petabytes of data on a sharding architecture. As you can imagine, 1&1 is one of the biggest web hosters and the total company, United Internet, I think the biggest in Europe. Almost the whole German internet, I think, together with Strato, also belongs to the same, now to the same body, is much of it is hosted at our data centers. And I'm talking about shared Linux web hosting here, specific applications, but I'm also talking about a general application, both in parallel. And it's up to you, or it's up to us to ask specific questions or the general ones. This is got to the open source part of it. So I have a specialized automation project, how to automate this. Container football, that means you are kicking around the containers and don't produce incidents, don't produce customer downtimes, except some accepted few minutes. And that's about what I'm talking about in this talk here. There are two main storage architectures in today's world. One you probably know is the so-called big cluster architecture, and it's propagated by almost all of the people in the internet or anywhere. It means you have two kinds of servers, storage nodes, and you have some so-called front ends. For example, a good example is Ceph clusters. You need a storage network, typically a dedicated one, because you don't want to mix this traffic, the storage traffic, which is in real time, with normal customer traffic. So typically, in talks, they say the network is all everywhere and it's for free. No, it isn't for free. The idea of big cluster architectures, you have a lot of storage nodes, ranging up to thousands, and you also have the same amount of servers in so-called front ends. And they are interconnected by network, and you can see if you have n front ends and n back ends, you have O of n square connections to maintain at runtime. And this is describing the problem here. It means even if your traffic is only O of n, it means the network has to switch all of these packets from the right source to the right destination. And this makes the system complicated and will affect reliability. I will show you even some proofs of that, why it's worse, this architecture. First look at, in shared hosting Linux, we have millions of home pages, millions of customer home directories, because each customer is residing in its own directory and isolated from the neighbor, of course. So this means the data is already partitioned, okay? There is no need for storing each directory in a very, very big petabyte pool, in one single pool. Simply unnecessary. And this talk is going about what to do if you don't have one big pool, but instead some smaller ones. Okay, and what to do there? Because common belief is, up to now, you cannot manage this. You cannot load balance there. And I have a solution for it. Yes, you can. Okay, this talk is about this. Okay, data already partitioned, traffic already partitioned because each web space has its own domain name, DNS, all clear, And of course, you don't need to have one central IP address for all of these domains. So it's no problem to do what the next slide has as an alternative. It's a sharding architecture. Sharding means all your web pages, all your storage is on the same host in ideal case. So you have an array of machines, and each machine is populated with some thousands of customers. Or some hundreds, depends on the size of these machines. We have up to two terabytes per customer in extreme cases. And of course, we have some storage boxes which have 300 terabyte RAID 6 in one machine on 48 spindles. And in this case, of course, we have only several hundred customers on one machine. In other cases, we have up to 60,000 on one machine. Extreme cases, some very silly web pages, no PHP and so. Then you can condense to very, very high number of domains and customers on one machine. So it, you have a big range from very small machines to very big ones with respect to storage space and also with respect to number of customers. And if you look at the distribution function, how it is distributed, it's not equally distributed, it's no Gaussian distribution, it's an exponential distribution according to Zipf's law. That's the point here. Real data from real life isn't uniformly distributed in reality. Never. I have never seen it. It is with respect to CPU consumption, is unevenly distributed, memory consumption, unevenly distributed storage consumption, I/O, IOPS, also unevenly distributed, and so on. And this uneven distribution is the reason why you need some load balancing in some way. Okay, and the problem, common belief up to now in the world is you need a storage, a big cluster, and a storage network for this in order to be able to load balance, and this is no longer true. So the task here is you have storage plus front, it's just half the number of machines you need to deploy, half your costs, just by having less, and you have no dedicated storage network anymore. But what you should have is a replication network, which has, however, lower demands to the network. Because replicating your data to a second data center, also called geo-redundancy, is even cheaper than the big cluster in one data center. Even cheaper. You just need two data centers, and you need the BGP protocol or similar things in order to be able to switch over one IP address to another location. So at the network side, you need some support for it, which is typically BGP protocol with BERT or with Quagga or similar tools. And then the same IP, if you one server fails in one data center, you switch over the whole IP to another one. And the customer typically has no big impact from such a thing. So in our case at 1&1, we already have this replication network, because we started 10 years ago with DRBD replicating this data, and later we converted to MARS. MARS is an alternative to DRBD, but it's working asynchronously. While DRBD is working synchronously, MARS is asynchronously replicating. And I am at the moment only using MARS, which I am the author of, but I could even support DRBD in future at these higher levels. We'll talk about it later. And you have another advantage, you can even use traffic shaping there. If it's a congested network, you have no problem, because it's working in the background. Okay. Now, yeah, question?
What's redundancy? Is it only geo-redundancy or also redundancy in the cluster itself?
You can have any of those. If you already have geo-redundancy, you typically have RAID 6 at one machine, which is also redundancy, and you typically don't need another one. This is on this next slide here, why you don't need any more. I'll explain. Okay. You can have it, of course, you can have rect-to-rect redundancy similar to DRBD. It's also possible. And MARS, of course, does not only support two replicas. In practice, you will not have more than four replicas, theoretically, any number of replicas. But there's one difference to Ceph. Ceph is replicating objects, clear? Small objects. MARS is millions, billions, billions of objects. Mars and DRBD are replicating whole logical volumes. And one logical volume has strict consistency in itself. You have one primary machine where you can mount it or use it. The other ones are secondaries, if you know DRBD. Okay? So you have no active-active. You have one active machine, and the rest is passive of your replicas. Okay, and inside of your logical volume, you have strict consistency between them. You have eventually consistent model. But only in case of failure, if you do a planned handover, you also get strict consistency at a global level, because you just wait until the data has been fully transferred. Okay, so the model is a little bit different than having big clusters, and there are some details implied by this, and read my Mars manual, you will find tons of information about this and what to do there. Compute power. Yes. Well, this is what I will talk about later. In the appendix, I have an additional slide to this. But just let me continue the presentation, then we will come back in the question part. First, I will talk about reliability, okay? Because this is a big concern. We have also some Ceph clusters at 1&1, and they are not working as expected. And I have analyzed the problems. Why? Well, here you have an intuitive explanation. I have a mathematical model for it in the appendix of the Mars manual. So if you're mathematically interested, please discuss with me, because there might be bugs in this theory, so check it, please. But this is the intuitive explanation. Let's assume you have 1,000 servers, and you have 1,000 pairs. With DRBD, it would be in the same data center rack to rack. If you have Mars, then you would probably replicate it over bigger distance, longer distances, whatever. So you have traditional pairs by default. And now we look at node failures, the red ones, this one is failing, this one is failing. So in this case, it's a different pairs. It's no problem to just switch over to the green one in the pair. If you have the same in a big cluster, like, for example, Ceph, and you are replicating all your objects to all of your machines, and you have a replication degree of 2, same number of machines, and 2 ones are failing at the same time, then you have a problem, because some of our objects will not be accessible. Because some of the objects are, yes, I can imagine your question. Yeah? Yeah? One idea is, I did not fully understand your question. I should repeat it. Could you get a microphone and ask your question to the full audience or to the internet? Okay, proceed.
In your DRBD and Mars example, if the same nodes which are failing are both, which are the pairs, in this example of your slide, both which are connected are the red ones, you effectively have a downtime.
Yes, then you have a downtime, of course, but only one of your shards is affected, not the whole cluster.
Ah, okay.
That's the main difference.
Okay.
And I will come to this, you're right, I will come to this in the next slide,
okay,
where I have some numbers and this is explaining the problems with the Ceph clusters. Because typically, the probability for hitting exactly the same pair, both nodes of the same pair, is very, very low. In the next slide, I have some probability figures for it. Here, it is n to hit any two, because you are uniformly distributing all of your objects, billions of objects, to your nodes, and you always will find some pair where For almost any pair, you have common objects. If you have a replication degree of 2 here. And this is the reason, probably one of the reasons, why official Ceph guidelines and similar are telling you should use 3 replica. It needs more hardware.
This is only correct if you use replication. If you use the Rayman coding, you get larger failure domains.
Yes, the question was about erasure encoding. And my answer is, I'm recommending with gRBD and Mars, you are using RAID 6 at each of these machines locally already. So this is the same as erasure encoding, but not spread over the big cluster. It's only local erasure encoding. And for performance and for other reasons, you shouldn't use it in the big cluster. So you have two kinds of redundancy. One at the RAID level, low level, okay? And another one at the machine, at the node level. And I'm only talking about the node level at the moment, but you are right, the other one is also very important. You are very, very right with this. But I, as a Marshall DRBD guy, I am regarding this as already solved by RAID levels, even by hardware RAID. Okay, or what was your question? You mean you have enough redundancy in total? Yes. Yes, you are right. This is possible, but the same can also be easily done here. Yeah. For yes, you are right, the model is restricted. I'm just, as told here, I'm looking only at node failures and I'm neglecting the other cases. And in Mars manual, you find even more conditions. Because in my presentation, I cannot talk about all of those conditions. I have hopefully described it correctly. If you want to check it that it's correct, please do so. Because there might be bugs in my description, please start checking it. Yeah? So, of course, I might be wrong somewhere. My son has found a bug in a mathematical formula. Because he's studying informatics in Karlsruhe, so he has found a bug in my formula, already corrected now. But there may be further bugs, so if you find one, please contact me and show it to me. Because I want to have a correct description here. And there might be bugs, of course. I'm failing as other humans are also failing. But typically, you need more replicas for compensation of this. And, is there any question about this? It's clear, the difference. The fixed pairs is more restricted with respect to sysadmin tasks, because migration of your data is not as easy as in the big cluster. Big cluster means already distributed, yes? Inconsistency. Like DRBD, yes. Like DRBD, you have full sync or fast full sync, Mars, and so on. So one of those, you can even have the split brain situation. Yeah, but this is common for those types of. Already solved, there are mechanisms for it, but neglected in this case here. Yeah, but the similar problem, the problem domain, also occurs here. Yeah, and how it's solved, I don't know because I'm no Ceph expert. Okay, so well. For the next slide, I have one pre-slide. Some of the assumptions, not all, are depicted here. For the example, I'm assuming that one server has two nines after the dot, four nines in total. So it means from 10,000 operating hours, you have 1 hour of downtime, a statistical average. Okay? That means if you have 10,000 hours are about 13 months or a little bit more than 1 year. So it means 1 hour downtime per year and per server. Okay? Easy to understand. And I'm looking only at temporary failure. If you would look at permanent failures, then we get in the disaster zone. Okay? But I'm not looking into the disaster zone. So this is the easier part. Then assumption is the server are independent, which is not true in practice, but whatever, for mathematical model, just for an academic model, it's easier to compute with. And assumption for big cluster that all objects are spread to all servers, and there are countermeasures not doing this. I will explain later. And sharding architectures, DRBD or Mars, are just using pairs, triples, and so on. As a classical DRBD. If you have used DRBD for more than 10 years, you will know it already. Okay, and what means if you have 10,000 servers, almost all of the time, one of those servers is down. You have a permanent incident. And this is just the task to be solved here and to deal with it. So next slide. Now I come up with some numbers. This is a mathematical model. What will happen in those? Let's first start with the thick red line here. This is the easiest one. It's just plain servers, local RAID, RAID 6 or RAID 10 or whatever. This is probability of 1 to 10,000. And this is the customer downtime. If your server breaks down, if one of 10,000 breaks down, you have 1 hour downtime of one server per year, per 10,000 hours. Okay, if you have 10,000 servers, the whole thing is, or 10,000, the whole thing is going up by a factor of 10,000. Both scales are logarithmic here. This is log scale. Y-axis is also log scale here. Okay? So it's in the log scale, both axis log scale, it's very simple here. So let's look at first at the DRBD or MARS pairs. If you have pairs, then the probability of the downtime is reduced by a factor of 1 to 10,000. Okay? That means the line is parallel in log scale, parallel to the one. With pairs, you just improve your reliability by a factor of 10,000. You have the downtime, total downtime is improved by a factor of 10,000. Okay? Understandable, hopefully. Now what happens with a Ceph cluster if you distribute all of your objects to all of the machines? The easiest case is this one. You have no redundancy, only one replica of all objects. What you can see is if you have 10,000 machines, and almost always of the time one of them is down because of the assumptions, then your whole Ceph cluster will not work at all. Clear? Yeah. And this is the reason why this red line is converging against this dotted line. The dotted line is the total number of operating hours which is existing in the cluster. So this means you have this permanent incident, and this permanent incident implies a physical incident in the sense that some of your objects are not available. It's possible to argue with differently. It's explained in the MARS manual, but please not in the presentation, because then we get into some esoteric areas. But I have even mathematical formulas for those cases. Hopefully they are correct. I'm not sure. Maybe there's a bug, so please check if you have a mathematical interest. So first, is it clear to understand why it converges against this dotted line with one replica? Now your question, the next question is, for sure, what about two replica? Increasing the number of replicas. And you can see it also converges against the same. What's the reason for it? The x-axis here is the number of basic storage units. So if you have two replicas of 10,000 machines, you need two replicas, you need 20,000. You need to double your machines, okay? And if you have 20,000 machines, two of them will be down all of the time. And this means increasing the number of replica does not help at all. This is a fundamental property of this architecture. Increasing the number of replica does not solve this problem. Clear? And this is the reason why, well, you can use four replicas. It's always it's converging a little bit later, that's all. But in the principle is the same. So, well, it helps to have more replicas. And interestingly, I checked where this line is crossing the basic line here. And interestingly, this is about the practical size limits of Ceph clusters as observed at 1 and 1. They are not really scaling below about in the range of this, where you see the crossings in practice. And the outcome of this observation, practical observation, is they have to be sharded. You need shards of Ceph clusters in order to overcome this problem, at the moment at least. But probably there will be some solutions for this, of course, also in the Ceph world. But this is a principal property of this type of architectures. Okay, and even I have a mathematical proof that these lines here, DRBD or MARS, are the best possible ones. There exists no better solution. This is the globally best solution. And as an experienced sysadmin, you will likely agree, because if you have ever had experiences with RAID 0, you know RAID 0, what it is? RAID 0 is just striping your data about more and more disks. And if you increase the number of disks, you're increasing the risk. If one disk dies forever, then you, all of the data is gone. Of course, you are losing not all of the data, but stripe, so that means you get a Swiss cheese then afterwards, missing data. And the same is also true for any other distribution method, whether you use RAID 0 or you do the same with object, whatever you do, to get the same problem. If you have a classical file system like XFS, for example, and you lose 1 million of your data blocks, what do you think? Is it operable or not? It's not. Why? Because you need an offline file system check at least in order to repair some of it. And that's the problem. File systems or other high-level objects are using blobs, big objects, a block device or a virtual block device or whatever, and all of the data must be present. You must not lose anything inside of this. And this is the problem to be solved. And spreading your objects makes it worse. So having the lowest number of machines, spread through the lowest number of machines, is the best possible solution. It's really trivial to see. Okay, any questions about this slide? Because this is, I think, the most important for the motivation part. Okay.
So I did it right. The best practical number of units, server units for SAP is about 100.
No, I'm not sure. This is an observation, not in general. Please do not generalize. It's just an observation at one specific implementation for a specific use case. And by accident, it looks similar to these theoretical explanations. And there are many differences because this is an assumption here. That the 99.99 is an assumption, not measured in practice. OK, but by accident, it looks very similar. And the principal behavior of extending your Ceph clusters is really similar to what describing the theoretical model says. Don't translate it one-to-one from this theoretical model into a practical use case. Please don't do that. But the principal behavior looks like not completely wrong here. Okay. This is, in detail, there's a small difference. Because as a scientist, I have to be very careful here. Clear. Because, yeah. No, another question? This is an assumption, that one of 10,000, assumption, yeah? No. The assumption is that the machine is temporarily down, and when it comes up, the data is present again. Because any local failures, if there are, have been already compensated by the local RAID. That's the assumption. We are looking not at permanent failures here. If you introduce permanent, it becomes even more the difference is even more bigger.
But there is probability that these two machines that are not available are the same.
Yeah, no. Should I go back to this last slide? Do we have some time for it? We are losing some time on this discussion here, but I can invest it. If you want to, is it an important question for all of us, or should we discuss later? Discuss later, okay. Because otherwise we will lose. Because I want now leave this motivation and this fundamental law. This is last slide to the fundamental laws. You can see the proof in marsmanual.pdf in my Mars project. URL is later. And there's the proof I already told you, the best possible reliability. No better one. Big cluster is never better, whatever you do. And, well, and it becomes even worse if you look at the questions you asked. You already asked this question here. It's a small sentence, but we have no time for looking into all of the details now. Okay, and you are right. You are just repeating what common belief is up today. Well, and I'm arguing against common belief. This is clear. Common belief is not easy to change. It will take some time. It's only, but fundamental laws of physics and mathematics are stronger in the long term. It may take some decades, but you cannot fly faster than speed of light. It has taken several decades until Einstein's law was accepted by the whole world. Now it is accepted, but not immediately accepted at once. Okay? So you are right in the past. This argument is not completely wrong. There's a reason for this argument. And well, in future, I will not claim that it's already solved now, but in future it's solvable, and I have started creating a solution for it. But of course, in order to reach really enterprise grade for a lot of applications and a lot of use cases, much more work is needed. So this is just treated as a prototype while it's in production at 1&1, and one certain implementation, container football. But of course, to really be used worldwide in the industry, it needs much more work. And this is also an opportunity for open source project. This is why I'm also talking to developers, not only to sysadmins here. Okay, now I should start explaining how it works. So back from away from theory, go to practice. I'm assuming that you have a logical volume, LVM, logical volume manager at each of your nodes of your sharding machines, and you can create new, you have some spare space on this host B. You want to migrate this host A to host B, and you need some spare space, obviously. There, enough. Well, how does it work? You look, here's your size. You look up at the size of the old machine. It can be extended dynamically at runtime over some years. Then you create the same number of data here, logical volume, create. And then you say Mars RDM join resource, you have Mars running here. You just create another replica with this single command. It's similar to DRBD. DRBD has also join resource commands in the meantime, I've heard, but I have not used it for some years. Okay, this means you are creating a replica, and now it takes several hours to have a fast full sync running, where the data blocks are being transferred while the data is being altered. The machine is running at the primary host, and we are just creating another replica, another one. Okay, then we have to wait for up to date. I can give you some numbers. Typically, with very slow, if you have only 100 gig, it's less than an hour, I think, depending on the network. If you have 10 gig uplinks, the old hardware has only 1 gig uplinks. It takes longer, and so on. The biggest containers we have are about 40 terabyte per one container, then it runs several days, okay? But we have 10 of them on one machine, and full sync of a full machine of 300 terabyte takes about 1 week, about over 10 gig uplinks from one data center to another one. So of course, there are two operations, start your kick, so like in football, you are playing, and hopefully the ball will reach the goal. Some when it takes a few seconds in football, here it takes a little bit longer, but the principle is the same. Start your kick, and then the ball is coming down a little bit later. So, and after it's on the new side, you just switch the primary side, similar to DRBD. If you know DRBD, it's the same command, almost the same. Just use Mars ADM instead of DRBD ADM. And then you start your application by your cluster manager or application manager. You can also use systemd for starting or whatever you are using. Okay, that's the basic principle of it. The 1&1 implementation has some much more details about it I want to talk about. We have, on this host side A, we have host A1 and A2. We have two ones. So we are creating two new replicas in parallel, and then we are destroying two of the old ones afterwards. And in this way, we are able to migrate old, to get rid of old hardware, old IBM blades in this case, are being removed and replaced by newer hardware. Okay, any questions? It's relatively simple for experienced sysadmins, it's clear. If you just know that you can dynamically create whatever number of replicas you like to create. You just need enough storage space. Of course, you have to wait some time until the sync is finished. But during this sync time, you have no customer downtime. One number about downtime observation at 1&1 is 3 minutes at the moment. Most of this time is spent in cluster middleware updates, because our cluster software is not able to deal with four replicas at the same time, only with two. We have to change some database entries, and this takes some time and some other things. This is costing most of the downtime, but 3 minutes is no problem for a web hoster if the 3 minutes are during midnight or whenever. So just to get some impressions. And of course, you can augment it with runtime migration. It's also possible, but not yet implemented. So now we get one level up. We assume that you already have automated the mechanics we have seen in the last slide. And now you have two high-level options how to automate this. The one is you have a planner. Planner means you are creating a stateful plan with some interdependencies, what to do here. For example, for hardware migration, a planner is sufficient. If you want to do it in a better way, as I think, you have an optimizer where you just specify the host to be emptied and you have some target machines to be populated, or it automatically selects all of the available machines as target machines. And then you have stateless actions. One stateless action means here, if possible, just migrate one container, and then possible do it also in parallel, many of those actions in parallel. But the runtime of each football kick operation may be different, and the stateless machine here, similar like a controller loop or similar to Kubernetes, just works by doing what is the next step which is possible. It has no notion for checking the future, not necessarily. It can do, but it doesn't need to. Okay? One question, you are not looking confident. What's the difference? Okay, with a stateful action plan, you mean typical planning, as typical planning in industry. So what's the internal architecture of the system? Well, let's start with the bottom line, I think. This is clear. You have some hardware RAID. Typically, you also can use software RAID, but not recommended, because you have a BBU. BBU means battery backup cache. The fastest type of cache you can have at this hardware controller card is RAM, up to 8 GB with newer models. And it's extremely fast if you penetrate it with repeating requests, if you have some hotspots, databases, and so on. Well, then you have a block layer after on top of it. First, you have LVM, local LVM. And what this whole football game does is, in essence, creating a virtual big LVM of your whole pool, a virtual one. You have only local logical volume management at each of your machines, but you are creating a virtual big logical volume pool, logically. So, and for this, you can need some cluster managers. We have a proprietary one, CM3, which is not public. It's not usable as open source, not under GPL. And it's firmly bound to some internal one-on-one databases. So you cannot use it, but I have published a plugin for it. So you can read the code. That's all you can do with it. And I have another plugin for systemd to be used as a plugin, as a cluster manager in the sense of one-on-one. So it means if you do the MarsRD in primary command, it will shut down systemd by systemd, the old side, then do the Mars handover, and it will start systemd targets for the target machine. So handover is working, tested in the lab, but not productive at the moment. What we use at one is LXC containers on top of XFS. That's all. The other ones are possibilities. The gray ones are possibilities for future, anyone who wants to contribute to the project. Same also for KVM. If you want to support for libvirt, I would like that, but not yet implemented, because we don't use it at one-on-one at the moment, because it would abstract from the type of whether you have an LXC container or whether you have a KVM. You can even, with some additional scripting, you can convert even the types between them, with some restrictions, of course. Okay, so this is the black arrows are the data paths where the actual petabytes and terabytes and so on are going through thick pipelines, okay? And these red lines are very thin ones in reality, because it's most of it is not always SSH. And this means it's just commands, a few kilobytes. No, not really, but of course important data. And here we have two layers on top of it, the purely execution layer. It's not an orchestration, it's a choreography. What does it mean? Do you know a roundabout in traffic? So if you drive by car and go to a roundabout, you have to check whether a roundabout is free. So you are synchronizing yourself with what else is going on in the pool. You have no central conductor for the whole orchestra who says, you, now you have to play, and now you have to play. No, you get your role, what you have to do, and now act by yourself and synchronize yourself with your neighbor actors. That's the idea behind the choreography, so it's solved with locking. Some distributed locks, deadlock free, with some method by Kaufman. And this is already an enterprise grade in production being used. In the next slide, I will explain how much of it. And the top layer is in early alpha stage at the moment. The reason for it is because 1&1 has uses it at the moment only for hardware lifecycle, for migrations of hardware, not for other goals. And therefore, somebody else has written a planner in Python, in a completely different framework. It's not under GPL, and it's firmly bound to internal 1&1 databases. So it cannot be used in the community, I think. So this place is occupied from the sense of 1&1, but from the viewpoint of community, this place is empty. I would like to do it, but I'm unsure whether I get the time to do it at 1&1. I'm not sure. So, any questions to it, we can zoom into some details. The generic pool optimizer, this is in plan. By concept, it's almost stateless. The reason for it is because if you have state there, the complexity will explode. State in distributed system is evil. No good idea. Try to minimize state in distributed systems as much as possible. That means state is always present. You cannot avoid it, but the state is in your machines. They have a certain state at the moment, like outdated, or like something has broken down, or whatever. This is state, the current status. But don't store the state somewhere else if not necessary. Don't store it in databases. Always check the real state, the actual state of the machines, and use this. So you just synchronize to whatever happens at what machine. If somebody plays around by hand and does whatever he does, destroy a logical volume because there's some operational problem or whatever, does it by hand. It must adapt, your system must adapt to it. And this is just the reason why I've made it stateless as possible. State is only here at the machine pool. The status cache is not real state, it's just for speed up. It's always synchronized to be good enough. Several input drivers, so by plugins you can extend it to another protocol, not even SSH, you are not firmly bound in the long-term future. Output drivers at the moment, I have the actions described in a very classical file format, you all know. So you can import it into Excel sheets, management can look into it, you can post it into a ticket or whatever you like. Or of course you can do automatic actions with it. And only one of the many columns is really used because there's the command to be executed. For the next layer, for the football engine. And this one is actually working here, football.shell, it's a shell script, several thousand lines of code, with lots of plugins. Some of them dealing with cluster manager, CM3 at 1&1, but also one dealing with systemd as a cluster manager. Output drivers going to the machine pool via SSH, this is the basic idea. And there are lots of tunables and parameters. At the moment, we have 140 in this implementation. And lots of actions and commands. So if you type football.shell --help, you will see an overview. And if you add --verbose, you will see the 140 tunables, okay? So look into it, it will take some time. Documentation is not yet really at the stage I would like, of course, because it's always under time pressure. And then the human interface. Screener.shell is a very simple thing. Each football process might run several hours or days in worst case. That means you're starting many of them in parallel. And as a sysadmin, you want to check if there's some problem or not. So it runs in screen sessions, you know, the command line tool screen. It's running as shell in screen sessions. You can attach to it, you can interrupt it with Control C, you can look around and so on. So this is an optional, therefore it's dashed lines here for humans. If needed, you can attach. But most of the time, our sysadmins are running unattended now, since a few weeks. They don't attach to it, typically. It just runs in background, and the screen session terminates automatically when the script is terminating. This screener is just an interface, an intermediate layer, which is theoretically even optional. You don't really need it. But it's useful, because you see, you get an overview of sessions, which are currently running, which are currently failed, which have whatever problem. You can see this, and which are already done. Okay. Any questions for this? Okay. Well, this is almost the last slide. Almost. Current status, what do we have? It's under GPL with lots of plugins, not all of them usable for open source communities, but about two-thirds of lines of code are generic and are intended to be used at the world, not only at World 1, at least intended by me. Actual usage may mean that you should get in contact with me, of course, in order to, you might need to write some plugins. May happen or not, depends on your use case. So these are these two projects. One is Mars, the generic transport mechanism here, which is really generic and has its manual, describes all of, and the football containing these shell scripts. Now the main operations at the moment implemented are migrate, it's clear, your logical machine name to the target cluster. And the CM3 implementation automatically sets the same data center as before. If the old target was running in Brauerstraße in Karlsruhe, the target machine will automatically be also at the same data center, for example. And so this is the football kick operation. It's called migrate. Shrink is another internal thing because we have many XFS file systems which are only filled by 30% now because some customers have been moved away at a higher level via rsync move space to another machine, and then the file systems contain a lot of waste, a lot of empty space, and in order to shrink them, there's no online shrinking operation for any file system I know of, or do you know some? You can extend, yes? Butterfress? But currently not recommended for productive use. I should repeat the question. The question is, Butterfress, you think, has this option? Okay, with ButterFS, if you really would have it productive, which we don't, then you probably could solve the problem with less customer downtime because the last incremental rsync, incremental one, is very slow because it needs to be cached in the de-entry cache of the kernel. Please take a micro. I also cannot understand your question. But we are now just going to discussion because I'm almost done with my presentation, and in time, it's no problem. We can even start discussion now.
So the main trick with ButterFS is only use it on a single block device. Never try to use any of the RAID features because they're all broken as hell. But if you, usually what I do is I just use it on top of LVM because in LVM you can resize the actual block device.
Okay.
And with ButterFS you can resize the actual file system and you can resize all of that at runtime without any downtime at all.
Okay, this means you have experience with ButterFS and even a positive one. So it's nice to hear this, very nice to hear. I'm interested in, so we should talk afterwards about some more details. But the typical problem as current practice is that for shrinking you need to reorganize yourself. For example, the default XFS AG count parameter is only 4 with bigger file systems. At least some old Debian have this default, and this is a performance bottleneck, for example. So at the same time when we are shrinking file systems, we are also reconfiguring some important XFS parameters at the same time. So we have two reasons for doing this. Expand, of course, works online without downtime. This is trivial almost. You can do it with any file system. DRBD is supporting it. Marv is supporting online resize during operations with no downtime. Just allocate some more space, first low level, and the script expand has just automated it, bottom up, the whole stack, from low level until the higher one. Next question, or yes?
I should just add, with Butterfest, I only use it with current mainline kernels, so I'd never use anything older than kernel 4.15.
Okay.
So
yes.
I wouldn't use it on like CentOS or any of those arcane distros.
You're right. You have a very old kernel in production for several reasons, which is not subject here. Okay, and I have to maintain it for internal one, and I know the upstream fixes what's going on there. And okay, but different story, not for this presentation here. Okay.
I have more or less three questions. If you're using something like FSTrip, about the question with downsizing, you can get the, if you're using thin LVM, you can size down the image because the free parts of it get reduced to zeros, and if you have discard on, it knows, oh, this is empty space, I don't need to use it. I'm not 100% sure how LVM does handle this, but if you're using like ZFS, then it's possible that these blocks are really free and you gain the storage back.
Yes, experience I had several years ago, almost 10 years ago, is the performance is much worse because you have dynamic allocation of blocks during runtime.
Yeah, that will
that's
help.
Obvious, but there are use cases, you're right, for a heating.
And if you're just on, for example, SSDs, that is not so much of an issue as anymore.
It's typically hurts performance, but has obviously better space.
Yeah, has some drawbacks.
Yes, and currently you are right, not yet supported by Mars, but supported by DRBD.
Oh,
it's an optional feature I want to get some time to implement. I have not the trim in Mars at the moment. It's relatively easy to do, but get the time for implementing. Okay, so it's another to-do for me. You are right.
I assume one issue with your solution is that you just have always one active node, so you don't have load balancing for the request. So you have just one container running and not, for example, three or four that serve the request.
Yes, and this is necessary to do.
Yeah,
it's
if
not
you
an
wanted
accident,
to have
because
like
because we have long distance replication. You
shouldn't try
to do a single IO requests over bigger distances than 50 kilometers.
That's understandable, but that's a limitation of that system, I guess.
Yeah, it's a limitation, but let me just add.
Yeah.
This limit, the football is just overcoming this limitation. You do load balancing not at each single IO request, you do load balancing at a higher granularity. Please switch over your whole container to a different location. If you have a problem at this location, go to another one. It does load balancing, but not at each single I/O request. That's the main difference. And the difference is also migration of data means that the access patterns from your application to the data is shortened. Because you keep your data near your application, and in order to achieve this goal, you migrate it. And migration is a slow process, a batch process running in background, even with traffic shaping and similar things. It's not real-time I/O traffic anymore. And this real-time I/O traffic you have is typically at your local rate controller, because your SAS cables and your SAS bus is also a distributed system, but a local one, which is only a few meters and not a few kilometers. That's the idea behind it.
I was for the load balancing. I was more like, if you have a customer that uses a lot of CPU power with its website, then you may run into issues there.
Yes, and this is another use case for football. If you have certain customers, you have two options. A certain customer, if it's only one customer, you just migrated away this one customer at rsync level at web space level. And if the whole machine has some issues and you have bad hardware or you have too many containers, typically seven on one machine, you reduce it by a football. Just migrate or have less containers on this machine.
Okay. Yeah.
So of course you have to do it at a higher level, not immediately, it takes some time, but you can load balance it. And this is just the reason for the pool optimizer, not a planner. The optimizer is planned, should obey not only the storage space, but also other dimensions like CPU consumption and RAM.
Yeah.
This is planned by me. And simultaneously look at all of those dimensions and then do the optimum thing. Optimize it some way. It's an NP-complete problem even to be solved here.
Okay?
Okay?
And the last one that I have is, so it's about the practical point to this. So your containers do include the whole stuff that is needed for the web space. So for example, there's a database, there's a web server, there's PHP in there.
No, not at the moment. You are talking about the specific one-on-one instance now.
Yes.
The generic has no restrictions.
Yeah, of course.
The generic thing. The one-on-one specific instance is using a very old architecture which has some decades of history, and you cannot change it easily.
You always have that.
Yes, you always have it in practice. So this is a different story. Of course, the generic project doesn't want. Before we stop, I just I'm not sure whether I can complete this optimizer project. I would like to tell you that I look for a new sponsor for the Mars and football project. So if you would have some application area, best would be more than 1 petabyte of enterprise critical data, because there it pays off to have a kernel developer and some people taking care for it. So having your special customized kernel and other things is no problem for paying this. The business case is then clear. If you have less than 1 petabyte, then it's better to use even commercial storage. Commercial storage is more expensive by a factor of 10, about a factor of 10. And then for the small cases, relatively small cases, it's better to just to use whatever, NetApp or whatever. Yeah, okay. But open source has its use case when you really have petabytes and thousands of machines. Okay, then what I am planning to do, but I'm not sure whether I can do it, go into a similar direction as Kubernetes, but on stateful storage space, not on stateless Docker containers. That's the main difference. Long-term perspective, from my point, is Mars has a different use case than DRBD. If you have been in my past presentations about DRBD and Mars, I have one slide I could explain. The main difference is the one is for long-term, long distance. The other one is for short-distance replication. And of course, the network can have some interruptions, outages, or whatever. Mars tolerates all of this. With DRBD, you can become crazy, really, in some cases, some use cases. And what I want to stress as my last sentence, but we can continue discussions because we have 3 minutes. I've now decades of experience with this use cases. Okay, then next question.
So you got asynchronous replication. How fast is the replication?
How fast?
Because,
very interesting question. Yeah, you are right.
My question is this, if your customer writes a few gigabyte of data or even a few hundred megabyte, and suddenly the connection is lost, the server goes down, and the data is not replicated, and it gets switched over to another IP with an older version, there are inconsistencies.
Okay, many questions in one. I try to answer it, but it's a different presentation about Mars, not about football, your question, but no problem, I will answer it. It has a transaction lock on the /Mars file system. It works similar to MySQL replication, so all of the changes are recorded in this transaction log at the primary side, and this transaction log is replicated or transferred to the secondary side asynchronously in background. And this means you always get a consistent state. It's always consistent at the secondary, but outdated. So it may reflect a former state like you had a power loss, okay? And if you want a handover, of course, you have to wait until all of the data is transferred. So as a precondition for this football, you should check, and there is already a check in the football scripting, that the backlog is less than 1 gig. The current limit is tunable, as one of the tunables says, 1 gig, not more than 1 gig, in order to minimize the downtime. And otherwise, it doesn't start the downtime. Please wait until you have fixed your networking problems or whatever. Or fix the node peak, which creates the big load. Because Mars, with Mars, you can pump several gigabytes or 100 gigabytes in a few minutes. It's impossible to replicate it over the network because the I/O bandwidth of your local RAID is much, much, much higher than your network bandwidth for replication. And Mars is buffering all of this. But this is a feature, not a bug of Mars, okay? It's just the idea. If you have some extreme performance peaks, then just fix your application. Okay, official time is now over in 20 seconds, you are right. If one wants to continue, I am available past the official time. I would be available, or we can continue in a smaller circle, whatever you prefer. So from my side, well, there are lots of questions, it's clear.
Okay.
Okay.
So what if a host goes down? Will there be a replication started to another host? Because what if the server is damaged or something and doesn't get up by itself? Is the replication started on it by itself?
Yes, there's a forceful handover, like DRBD, primary minus minus force. Very similar to DRBD.
Automatically?
Not automatically, Mars not itself, but a higher level like a cluster manager can do it.
Okay.
Not Mars is just one component of the whole system, okay?
Okay, so a data center out, if then...
If you have a data center outage, then you have certainly more problems than only this
and
one.
The last thing, I think to the first slide, your comparison with Ceph is...
Reliability
is wrong at a few levels because you only consider the replication for RBD pools. If you use erasure coding for RBD pools, then the spreading is different than you think. You can fine tune where your objects are stored and how they're stored, and
yes.
You can even create pools for RBD images that are linked with this, so you can have multiple pools for
yes.
RBD images.
Yes, it is. Certainly there are more complex models which could be better, but the general mathematical proof that this is the best one under some exemptions will not, I am sure, will not be touched by this, okay? Because it contains no assumptions about this.